I want to welcome you if you're visiting for the first time and you're just on time, because we're starting a new series today. It's called EQ. Turn to your neighbor and say EQ. Turn to your other neighbor and say, she didn't make a mistake, she meant EQ. Because if you're like me, you're thinking, doesn't she mean IQ? IQ, I think, is the word she's trying to get at. Nope, I'm not talking about IQ. I am definitely talking EQ. And EQ stands for emotional intelligence. Turn to your neighbor and say emotional intelligence. This is not a normal topic for churches, but we realized that this was a significant topic. If those of you have been following us here and this is your home church, you will remember that we went through a series this past Sunday about blockbuster movies, and I did a message called Inside Out. We did a message based on the movie Inside Out. Raise your hand if you ever saw the movie Inside Out, the Disney movie. Phenomenal movie. It was, I think, better for adults than it is for kids, although it was designed for kids. And so we did this movie called Inside Out, and it talked about our emotions and how our emotions are important. They're God-given. And we had such a good response from that message that we realized as a staff that this is a topic worth pursuing. This is a topic that many Christians and non-Christians alike struggle with, our emotions. Can I get an amen? So for those of you that were not here, I'm going to quickly review, okay? So it's not in your notes, but I'm going to quickly review to give us biblical foundation to jump off of. I don't want to assume that everybody understands the biblical foundation. So I'm going to quickly review my notes from back then, the Inside Out. If you want to see that message, I believe you can get to it. Just go to newhopecentraloahu.org, click on the Haleiwa campus, and then all the messages are archived there, okay? But we started that message with Genesis chapter 1, verse 27, and we said that God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him, male and female, he created them. And we realized that we have emotions because God has emotions. Can I get an amen? And the first thing we settled on was that God has emotions, but he is not emo. Hallelujah. We get emo, God does not get emo. And this is why Hosea chapter 11 says, my heart recoils within me, my compassion grows warm and tender. I will not execute my burning anger. I will not again destroy Ephraim, for I am God and not of man. And so we see there that God is not emo. He has emotions, but he is not emo. He doesn't act out fleshly with his emotions. Your emotions are supposed to be a gauge. They are not supposed to be a guide. What does that mean? You shouldn't just simply follow your emotions. I'm angry, so I'm going to lash out in anger. No, you want something else to be your guide. Your emotions are natural. They're human. They're a part of your flesh, and you will struggle with your emotions until Christ comes back. Can I get an amen? But God knows that we are flesh. God knows that we are weak in our flesh. So he sends us the Spirit of God. And the Spirit of God lives on the inside of us. And he guides us with the Word of God. Because in Psalm 119, verse 105, it tells us, your Word is a lamp to guide my feet and a light for my path. So who is our guide? Jesus is our guide. The Word of God is our guide. Holy Spirit is our guide. That's how we can keep our emotions in check and not become emo. And how many of you guys know emo with uplifting a hand? Don't look at them if they're here. But if you know somebody who's emo, it's hard to live with people that are emo. It's not hard to live with people with emotions. I would say it's easy to live with people with emotions if they know how to keep those emotions in check with the Spirit of God. Can I get an amen? I would also say if you're here and you have no emotions, okay, that's very true in our society in Hawaii. There are a lot of people who have no emotions. It's hard to live with those people too. So you got on one extreme people who are emo and their emotions are all over the map. And then you got on the other extreme people who have no sense of their emotions. They're completely numb. They don't express joy or happiness or sad or anger. You just want to yell at them like, be mad or do something, right? They're like, you can't connect to them when they have no emotions. We also learned back then, when it comes to your emotions, we shouldn't deny them, we should deal with them, and we shouldn't reject them, we should allow the Lord to redeem them, okay? And how do we do that? We do that through the Word of God and by the power of the Holy Spirit. So that brings us to today's message, okay? Before we get into EQ, let's briefly look at IQ. So what is IQ? IQ stands for intelligence quotient. Turn to your neighbor and say, intelligence quotient. It's a global measure of a person's intelligence. It includes knowledge, reasoning, skills, logic, verbal and mathematical skills also. It was and is used to help categorize people and later to help in identifying learning disabilities. Let's stop right there for a second. So IQ is something that we're all familiar with. Growing up, people either were really high in their IQ, and we called those the brainiacs, right? Or they're really low in their IQ, and then those are the people who like had learning disabilities or learned slower. I was one of those people. And my kids, they never realized that I actually was had special education. When I was growing up, because I went to school as a four-year-old, I wasn't ready to learn how to read. So my parents had to put me in a reading program. I had they pulled me out of class to learn how to read because I was behind everybody. So according to the IQ thing, my IQ was lower than everybody else. In my mind, my IQ, there's nothing wrong with my IQ. Obviously, I'm functioning right now. I don't think there was anything wrong with my IQ back then. I was just not ready to go to school. Can I get an amen? And so I am one of those people who advocates for not necessarily sending kids to school too early. We need to make sure that they're ready. And so that when they do go to school, that they're going to be successful. They're not going to live their whole lives thinking, oh, well, I'm just one of those people with low IQ. Okay, the next slide. EQ is much newer measure. It is a much newer measure in relational realm. And so now what their psychologists are studying is IQ is important, but EQ is equally as important. Why is it relevant? EQ is the single biggest predictor of performance in the workplace and the strongest driver of leadership and personal excellence. In the workplace, 90% of high performers are also high in EQ. Just 20% of low performers are high in EQ. People with high EQs, emotional quotients, make an average of $29,000 more per year than low EQ. So I don't know about you, but how many of you guys would like to get $29,000 more per year just simply by raising your EQ, your emotional quotient? Go to the next slide. Okay, so what is EQ? Definition by Dr. Travis Bradbury. EQ is emotional intelligence. It's your ability to recognize and understand your emotions in yourself and others, and your ability to use this awareness to manage your behavior and relationships. I want to just take a moment here to give thanks to Dr. Brian Misaka, because this is not a normal message a pastor would preach. I am not an expert on EQ. I don't do therapy, although sometimes I feel like I'm doing therapy. But I'm not a professional psychologist, and I do have a psychology degree, so I am familiar with this material, but it was Brian Misaka, who sits on our board, who came out with all of these statistics, and he is a licensed psychologist. He does marriage counseling, and he has a lot of experience in EQ, okay? So this is his definition. I also found another definition, and I liked it. It was a little bit less heady. And it says that EQ is the ability to identify, use, understand, and manage emotions in positive ways. Turn to your neighbor and say positive ways. Because how many of us know you can use your emotions in negative ways? I've been there, done that. I am learning how to use my emotions in positive ways. And if you're like me, I'm much like Sherry. My emotions are on my sleeve. But I live in a society that tells you that if your emotions are on your sleeve, you're emo. They automatically assume you're emo and they like shun you. If you cry too much or you're too emotional, I can't handle your emotions. Especially if the person that you're with they don't have any emotions. If they don't have any emotions and you're totally emotional, then there's going to be rift in the work relationship or the marriage or whatever it is, right? And so I thought that my emotions were just a negative thing. I used to basically put myself down like, okay, well, everybody else is better than me because I'm emotional. And in truth, what I learned as I grew as a Christian is my very emotions are what allow for me to connect deeply to the Father. My very emotions are the things that allow for me to deeply connect to the things of the Spirit because I'm sensitive. Because I am so sensitive, I can walk into a room and instantaneously know if somebody's funky. And that's what we call it in my house. Somebody's funky, you know, not that they have BO or anything like that. Their attitude is a little funky. because they're being emo, right? I can go into a grocery store and know that there's evil there. I can just walk in. I remember we were in Portland, and my son, Micah, my oldest son, he's like this. He had this gift of discernment since he was like 13. And I recognized it immediately because we went to Tower Records. How many of you are familiar with Tower Records? They don't exist anymore, but Tower Records used to be down there by the mall, yeah? He walked, and I'm not saying Tower Records is evil. I'm just saying there was something evil in there. We walked into this store, and my son, 13 years old, he said, "Mom, can we leave this store, please?" I said, "Why? What's the matter?" He's like, "I don't know. It feels evil. Can we just go?" So my son and I had to stand outside on the street corner and wait for my husband. He refused to be in there. Well, I'm the same way. When we were in Portland, he's like, "Mom," I said, "you don't even have to say it, honey. Just keep on moving through the park. Keep on moving through the park." Because there were some parts of Portland that were a little bit, I don't know, could feel like the negative forces and the evil spirits just kind of lurking in some places. You're like, okay, I have the light of Christ in Jesus' name, you know? So my emotions and my sensitivity allows for me to be spiritually discerning. Can I get an amen? But when you use these emotions in positive ways, you can relieve stress. You can communicate more effectively. You can empathize with others. Those people who have no emotions or don't know how to express emotions, they don't know how to empathize with people. You know, if a person is emotionless and you just had a sister or brother die, don't go to them. They won't know how to cry with you. They won't know how to be sad with you. It's nothing wrong with them. They're not in tune to their emotions, right? When you have the ability to identify, use, understand, and manage your emotions in a positive way, you can overcome challenges. You can defuse conflict. Can I get an amen? Many times we've been in meetings and I could feel things escalating. I can feel and sense, okay, that person is getting downright nasty, angry. And so if you are good at EQ, you can diffuse that situation in an instant. You can redirect the conversation. You can say, "Oh, I think what brother so-and-so is trying to say is this," and try and be used by God to bring peace. Can I get an amen? So being in tune to your emotions and the emotions of others, that's what EQ is. It is not the smartest people that are the most successful or the most fulfilled in life. Okay? And we can prove that to you. Many of us know academically brilliant people. Raise your hand if you've ever met somebody that was just academically brilliant. Now, keep your hand up. Raise them high. Now, keep your hand up if that same person was socially inept. And you know what I'm talking about? They're just, y'all laughing, because you know what I'm talking about. They're just like downright brilliant. You're like, "Man, you got to be the smartest person I know, and yet socially awkward." They cannot be in social settings. They can't have conversations with people. I feel bad for those people, and I feel bad for myself when I'm trying to connect. Like, I'm trying to connect this person. I'm like, "Oh, man, we got to work at this." Just not too long ago, my husband and I, we met this stranger, and we were trying to work with him, but he was socially inept. I mean, he was very intelligent. We sat with him at a Wendy's, and we were talking story with him, and I'm like, "Wow, you are very intelligent." And he was going to teach English as a second language, super intelligent, finished his degree, but had no kind of people skills. Like, if he was happy, you wouldn't know it. If he was sad, you wouldn't know it. If he was angry, you wouldn't know it. He just was like the wall over there. I mean, it was just like, I'm not exaggerating, this is how he was. And I'm like, "Oh, praise the Lord. Okay, you need a little help in some social, we can help you with that," right? So it's not just the smartest people who are the most successful and the most fulfilled in life, okay? Intellectual intelligence, or IQ, is not enough on its own to be successful in life. IQ can help you get into college, but it's your EQ, your emotional quotient, that will help you manage the stress and the emotions of facing your final exams. It's your EQ that helps you interact with your roommates. It's your EQ that will help you interact successfully with your professors. It is your EQ. Your IQ can get you a job. It's your EQ that will help you keep your job. Can I get an amen? So EQ is equally as important as IQ, and that's why we're talking about it, okay? EQ can be broken down into two major parts and four basic skills, okay? So the two major parts are awareness and management. The two major parts are awareness and management. And I have no clue what your bulletin notes look like, so if you get lost, don't worry. I'm gonna get lost too, but Danny back there, everybody give a hand clap for Danny. She's gonna help me out. Because I couldn't open this keynote presentation. I had my own notes, and my notes and keynote don't match. But together, we're going to preach this. Right, Danny? It's you and I all the way, girl. We got this. Okay, so two major parts of EQ are awareness and management. There are four skills of EQ. They are the skill of self-awareness, the skill of self-management, the skill of other awareness, and the skill of others' management, okay? So don't worry, we're gonna go through each of those, but I think they just wanted you to know what was coming, okay? Notice the emphasis on skill. Turn to your neighbor and say skill. Why is that important? It is important because skills can be learned and they can be developed, hallelujah. Okay, so EQ and the skills that are required for EQ can be learned. Turn to your neighbor and say, you have hope. Turn to your other neighbor, say, it's not too late for you. And we laugh because all of us can grow in our EQ. Can I get an amen? I don't care how high you think your EQ is, it can get better. And I can prove to you that everybody wants to get better in this. One of the, outside of the Bible, one of the number one selling books of all times is by Dale Carnegie. How to Win Friends and Influence People. That is still a book that people read once a year. And why do people want to read that book? Because they're trying to grow their EQ. That's why they read it. Okay? If you've never read it, go buy it. Marilyn Hickey. How many of you know Marilyn Hickey? She's one of the founding mothers, if you will, Bible teachers. Okay? Founding. Like Joyce Myers grew up on some Marilyn Hickey. Okay? Till this day, Marilyn Hickey reads How to Win Friends and Influence People one time a year. Because what she does as a minister of God is to connect to God's people. Can you imagine if you had a pastor and a minister that didn't know how to connect to the very people they're trying to reach? They would not have much fruit. Amen? Y'all laughing. You know some pastors like that. If you know some pastors like that, pray for them because maybe they ain't supposed to be a pastor. Hallelujah. Okay, I think I connect to people, but sometimes I question whether I'm supposed to be a pastor. On my good days, I'm good, but on my bad days, I'm really bad, okay? The Apostle Paul was extremely aware of himself. That's why I love Paul. In Romans chapter 7, I'm not going to read it to you. It's Romans chapter 7, verse 14 through 25. It talks about how I know what I'm supposed to be doing that's right, and yet I do what's wrong. He knows how wicked his flesh is. He knows how sinful he is. He's so aware of himself. And because of that, he can lean on God and he can lean on the power of the Holy Spirit, right? Because in Romans chapter 8, verses 5 through 8, it teaches you how do you get your emotions under control? How do you get your fleshly desires under control? Well, it is by the power of the Holy Spirit. If you let your flesh lead you, then you're going to fall all into sin. But if you let the Holy Spirit lead and guide you, then you will live victoriously through Christ. Can I get an amen? That's not today's message. That's a message for another day. But the four skills of EQ is our message today. And the entire series is going to be about EQ, emotional quotient. Our goal by the end of this series is to raise your EQ to the next level. If you're a 5, you're going to a 6. If you're a 6, you're going to a 7. If you're a 7, you're going to 8. No matter where you are here today, our goal is to help everybody in our church go to a higher level in managing their emotions. There have been more church divisions, more fallout because of emotions in the history of the church. There's been more church separations. Paul and Barnabas even separated. They had a big old argument, and so they separated. God took that and made it into good. He turned an argument into two separate missionary trips. Only our God can do something like that. Is that not phenomenal or what? Okay? But even they had an emo moment. I wish I could have been there, man. I was like, oh, man, they exchanged some words, right? And so we want to help you by giving you some basic skills to grow in this area. Okay, so the first skill of EQ is the skill of self-awareness. The skill of being aware of the presence of an emotion occurring in you. Okay? It is your ability to understand your emotional tendencies, patterns, and buttons. Raise your hand if you know you have buttons. Let me tell you, I know my buttons, and the person who pushes them all the time is my husband. Hallelujah. Turn to your neighbor and say, thank you, Jesus, for our spouses. If you ain't married yet, well, it's coming. I don't care how in love you are, your spouse will know your buttons, okay? And I, you know what? That's a blessing. It is a blessing for your spouse to know your buttons. You know why? Because your spouse can push the button so that Jesus can show you where you're not letting him lord over. Every time my husband pushes my button, I'm like, oh, there it is again. There's my flesh. I just gotta let that one go to Jesus. Come on, Teresa, let it go. Let it go. And I remember Misha, she asked me, Mom, how do you just forgive so fast? I said, you know what, honey? I used to hold on to my anger for like weeks, months. We would do the silent treatment. And I said, I'm too old for that now. I'm too old and there's too much to get done. So if Glenn makes me mad, I take a couple of hours. I'm really mad. I can get the house clean real fast in those moments. Sometimes I'm wondering, is he making me mad because he wants the house clean? Because he's like that. He strategizes. I think to myself, I said, you know what? He over there, how can I push a button? Because then I know she get the house clean in an hour. I won't have to do nothing. But I'm most effective when I'm angry because I got to channel the anger somewhere. So I'll put it into cleaning the house, okay? And we had a moment this weekend, and I went for a walk, and then I was good after that. And the kids are like, how do you get rid of it? I just give it to Jesus. So I just say, you know what, Lord? I'm going to give that to you. And if he's wrong, you'll speak to him. I don't need to say nothing, you know? And if I'm wrong, you'll speak to me and check me. Amen? Okay, that's what it means to be letting Jesus be the Lord over your life and your emotions, okay? But you got to know that you have the buttons. You got to know that you're experiencing an emotion, right? You got to know if you're sad. You got to know when you're feeling anxious. You got to know when you're angry. You got to know when you're under stress. And if you don't recognize it and you don't rate it, then you don't know how to manage it. Can I get an amen? So you want to rate your feelings on a scale of 1 to 10. 1 out of 10 is a very mild feeling. Okay, I might be angry, so I'm like at a 1. 5 out of 10 is a moderate amount of emotion. Okay? 10 out of 10, that's the strongest experience of that emotion possible. When I'm 10 out of 10 with anger, the entire neighborhood knows. I would say the whole block, probably. I am very loud when I'm angry. If I'm at 10 to 10, we're in trouble. Praise God that as I learn to deal with my emotions, I can get it under control faster. I'm not at a 10 for very long. I can just like, you know what? You just get it together, right? But you have to be able to rate your scale, your feelings on a scale of 1 to 10. Let's take, for example, stress. Okay, stress is an example we all undergo, okay? What is happening in your body? Pay attention. I know that when I am stressed, immediately my back starts to get really, really tight. I was in a car accident when we were living in California and we were in college, and I had whiplash. So I actually had to go to physical therapy for 30 days, and they did this electrolyte thing. It felt really good, you know? They didn't massage it out. I was so tight, they couldn't even massage it out. And they use this electro thing, and now I know that when I'm under stress, that same place starts to get tighter and tighter and tighter and tighter. Eventually, Glenn will see my stress because one of my shoulders will go up to my ears, and the other one, I look like this. And then Glenn's like, honey, I got to rub that out. I'm like, no, don't touch it. It's owie. It's owie. I'm a big crybaby when it comes to pain. I'm like, no, it's too owie. It's too owie. So he'll rub Bengay on it. But I know that when I'm stressed, I know what's going on in my body. I feel it in my back. From the bottom of my back all the way up into my shoulders. What's happening in your mind? When I am stressed, I have more negative thoughts about my marriage and about my ministry than when I'm not stressed. Those are the two areas the enemy will come and try and pounce on me. It's about the ministry. It's about my marriage or my family. Rarely do I get super stressed out about my kids. My kids are amazing. But I know that I start to have negative, I spin on negative thoughts. What is happening in your spirit? When I'm under stress, I know that spiritually I'm a little bit distanced from God. How do I know that? I don't read my Bible as much as I used to. I don't want to listen to worship music because it irritates me. I'm under stress, okay? So you have to be aware of what's going on with you, okay? Self-awareness, next slide. Self-awareness of our emotions is the first step. You have to be able to say, I am angry. I am sad. I am stressed. I am frustrated. Whatever it is, you got to be able to be aware of it, okay? The second skill is self-management. The second skill is self-management. Once you're aware of what's going on with you emotionally, now you need to manage it. Management of your own emotion is super important. When we got hired as pastors, and we went through a leadership training. Obviously, we had served New Hope Central Oahu for 14 years. We did not go on staff right away. A part of our leadership development, if you will, was Pastor Mike identifying, can we manage ourselves? It is not Pastor Mike's job to manage my emotions. It's my job to manage my emotions. Am I getting angry and out of control? Am I depressed and emo all the time and I can't take those things to the Lord? You have to manage your own emotions. It is not your spouse's job to manage your emotions. It is not your parents' job to manage your emotions. It is not your pastor's job to manage your emotions. Only you can manage your emotions. Only you can take under authority what's going on with you. Can I get an amen? Go back one more, sweetheart. Okay. Understanding your strengths and weaknesses and stewarding them wisely, okay? Understand your strength and your weaknesses and then steward them wisely. Next slide. Okay, how do you manage stress in your life? I know for Glenn, he handles his stress by working out. I wish that was mine. But it's not. Although I'm learning. The other day I was pretty stressed out. I was aware of my emotions. I was frustrated, I was angry and irritated, and I just wanted to just, you know, just, you have those moments you just want to just let into somebody because you see things and you're just like, So I went walking, and man, that's a good thing for me to start doing when I'm frustrated because I walked really fast. Like I cleaned the house really fast, I walk really fast, so I got a good workout that day and I felt fantastic afterwards, so maybe that's why Glenn goes jogging, okay? So how do you manage your stress in your life? Maybe you need to turn to significant others for support. Maybe you manage it through prayer. Maybe it's exercise and relaxation like I told you that Glenn does. But figure out how you're going to handle whatever emotion that you're encountering. Skill number three, your awareness of other people's emotions, okay? First of all, let's define awareness. Awareness of another's emotions is empathy. Turn to your neighbor and say empathy. Okay, the definition of empathy is an educated guess about the emotional state of the other. And we say educated guess because how many of you know you can think you know what's going on in a person and you just really don't know what's going on in a person? They may be happy and you just think that they're not happy because they're not smiling. Like one time, I remember my kids asked me, how come Grandpa Tom never smiles? I'm like, I don't know. So I was driving with my dad. I said, Dad, the kids want to know why you never smile. Are you never happy? He's like, I'm happy, but if I walked around smiling all the time, people would think I'm stupid. I'm like, okay. Okay, that must be military. I don't know. I smile a lot. Does that people think I'm stupid? I don't know. I'm like, okay, Dad, you might want to throw them a smile every once in a while because your grandkids think you're mad. Right? So you may think you understand someone's emotions, but come on, it's hard, right, to really know where a person's at. But in order to empathize, you do your best educated guess, okay? It's a great relational skill to empathize with others. Empathy leads to connection. Empathy leads to healing. And empathy is awareness of another's world, okay? What's going on in that other person's world. Okay, next slide. Okay, skill number four, management of others' emotions. Now, I kind of understand this point, but I don't necessarily 100% agree with it because you cannot fully manage somebody else's emotions. I cannot tell Glenn, don't be mad. Okay? I think what they're trying to say here is what the example I gave you. If you know someone's getting angry, you can do certain things that help mitigate that anger by acknowledging them, by saying, hey, brother, I know how you feel. I feel the same way. This is what I found out. Or, yes, I could. If I was you, I would be angry too. But let's take that one to the Lord. Let's pray. Okay? So, but you can't completely control a person's emotions. You can help mitigate some of it. You can help them to master their emotions. But again, like I said earlier, you have to manage your own emotions. Okay, so me trying to manage your emotions, I'm not going to be 100% successful at that. Are you with me? Okay, we can empathize and then respond based on that empathy, which is why empathy is so important. If you are frustrated with a situation and you have no, if a person is frustrated with a situation and you have no empathy and you're like, just suck it up and get over it, that's not going to go over well with that person. Can I get an amen? You know, if somebody in your family died and you go to get support and you want to cry on somebody's shoulder and they're like, well, you know, you can only cry for so long. When are you going to let it go? Well, you probably won't be talking to that person anymore, right? We don't know when a person's grieving is over. My family has been grieving the loss of my sister for 3 years. I'm not going to tell my dad, Dad, really, do you need to go grieve her every Saturday? Like, I'm not going to tell him that. He'll get over it when he's going to get over it. I just need to be there to emotionally support him through it. Can I get an amen? Okay, next slide. Examples of someone who is depressed. Encouragement is good if they are depressed. Minimization is generally bad. Okay, if a person is depressed and they're sharing with you their situation and you're trying to minimize the situation because you're in your mind thinking you are making a mountain out of a molehill, really? You're like depressed, your house is messy. Come live with me for a while. Right? If you minimize it, that's usually not going to go over too good. Because a person who's depressed, that's like a huge thing for them, whatever they're dealing with. For them, it's like a 10 because of the emotion of depression. For you, maybe it's only like an issue of 1. But don't minimize what they're going through. Activity is generally good. So if you know a person who struggles with depression, getting them active is good. Glenn tells me all the time, Teresa, you have to exercise because it releases endorphins, okay? And endorphins are good. And so I'm like, yeah, endorphins are good. Well, he was right. Because when I was frustrated and I went for that very brisk walk around the block, I had some serious endorphins going on, and I felt like I could take on the world. I was like, yeah, whatever. I'm not going to let that bother me. Okay, so now my whole house knows mom needs to walk. The house is happy when mom is happy. So everybody, watch the baby so mommy can go exercise. Hallelujah, okay? Spending time with them is good if they're willing. Now, this is important. If a person is depressed, they may not be willing to spend time with you. Respect that. Respect that. And I would say if it gets really bad, though, you got to intervene. You got to intervene, okay? Don't just let them take themselves in the darkness of abyss and go down and down and down, dooby-dooby, down, right? You want to step in. Next slide. Romans 12:15 says, rejoice with those who rejoice, mourn with those who mourn. If you are not a person who knows and is aware of your own emotions, you will not be able to rejoice when others are rejoicing. You will not be able to mourn when others are mourning. Okay, so it's important for you to grow in your EQ so that you can empathize with people. In conclusion, we want to share with you the person who was the master at EQ. That was Jesus. And the greatest example we have of that is Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane. So we're going to read it together in Matthew chapter 26, starting with verse 36. It says, then Jesus, what is this in your notes? Do you have this in your notes? You don't have this in your notes. I'm going to point out some words to you, write them in your notes, and go home and circle them in your Bible. Then Jesus went with his disciples to a place called Gethsemane. And he said to them, sit here while I go over there and pray. Okay? That's your first word I want you to see is pray. Verse 37 and 38. He took Peter and the two of sons of Zebedee along with him, and he began to be sorrowful and troubled. Okay? In another translation, it says he was distressed. He was distressed. Then he said to them, my soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death. So Jesus is not just sad. At this point, Jesus is so overwhelmed by his sadness that he feels like he's gonna die. I might say that people who deal with depression, that's how they feel. They feel like they're physically gonna die. That's how overcome they are by their emotions. And Jesus himself felt this. Why? Why is Jesus feeling this? Because he knows what he's about to face. He knows physically what it's going to take to endure the cross. He knows the will of the Father, right? More importantly than the physical anguish and the physical pain that he's going to suffer, he knows the emotional and spiritual suffering he's getting ready to face. Because when he goes to the cross, he takes the sins of the world upon him. And in that moment, when all of the world's sins come upon him, he is no longer in the presence of his Father. He is separated from his Father. You have to understand, from the moment he was born, he has never understood or experienced separation from God. But the moment he takes our sin, he is separated from God. And I don't know if you can wrap your head around that. But that, to me, I think, is what gave him so much sorrow. How many of you know it's not always the physical stuff that hurts you the most? It's the emotional and spiritual stuff that really hits you. And I think that's why he's so overwhelmed by his sorrow. So he cries out to these brothers and he says, stay here and keep watch with me. Turn to your neighbor and say, stay here and keep watch with me. Verse 39. Going a little farther, he fell with his face to the ground and he what? He prayed. There it is again. I want you to go to your Bibles and I want you to circle every prayer word you see because it comes up a lot, okay? He fell to the ground and prayed and he cries out, my Father, if it is possible, may this cup be taken from me. What cup is he talking about? He's talking about the suffering down the road of Calgary. He's talking about the nailing on the cross. He's talking about the stripes on his back when they whip him. He's talking about the crown of thorns that they're gonna stick into his head. He's talking about, I don't want to be separated from you, Father God. I do not want to experience spiritual death. He's saying, take that from me. If it is possible, take it from me. In this moment, Jesus is not trying to rebel against the will of the Father. In this moment, Jesus is dealing with his emotions. In this moment, Jesus is being very aware of his emotions. In this moment, Jesus is wrestling with the same humanity you and I wrestle with. And he says, however, yet, not as I will, but your will be done. He's struggling with his emotions. He's struggling with his sorrow. He's struggling from what's coming on. He's in his flesh saying, I don't like do this. If it's possible, take it from me. And yet he says, not my will, but your will be done. In Matthew chapter 26, verse 40, it says, then he returned to his disciples and found them, what? Sleeping. Brothers and sisters, there are many, many times you and I are found caught sleeping. Now, they were physically sleeping. I'm going to tell you that you can be sleeping with your eyes wide open. Can I get an amen? All kinds of emotions are going on in you, within you, around you, and you are sleeping. You don't even know what's going on. You're completely clueless, okay? And Jesus is saying, could you, men, not keep watch with me, not even for an hour? He asked Peter, watch and what? Pray. Watch and pray so that you will not what? Fall into temptation. Brothers and sisters, I'm here to tell you, the key to mastering your emotions is prayer. You need to be awake, you need to keep watch, and you need to be on your face in prayer 24/7. The Bible teaches us that you should pray without ceasing. How does that happen? You're in the grocery store. You are ever mindful of the presence of God. And you're interceding and you're praying. Lord, let me be what I need to be today for the people you bring my way. Can I get an amen? You're in the heat of the battle you're exchanging blow for blow with your spouse, your significant other, your sibling, your mom, your dad, your coworker, your boss, whoever it is. You need to be awake. You need to go, whoa, 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 hold up, hold up, hold up. Flesh is taking over. Flesh is taking over. You need to excuse yourself. You need to go to the potty room. You say, I'll be right back at you. You go in the bathroom and you get on your face and you pray. And you say, Father, I cannot do this apart from you. Take this emotion and crucify it to the cross, that I might not be led by my flesh, but that I will live according to the Spirit of Almighty God. I know that that is easier said than done, but it all starts with your choice. In the moment you have your emotions out of whack, you have to choose to take it captive and say, nope, 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 not going there, nope. I'm not gonna hate my spouse. I'm not gonna think about divorce. I'm not gonna lash out. I'm not gonna give him a verbal lashing. Okay, you said too much already, zip it. Bite down till it bleeds. Hallelujah. And this is what Jesus is trying to teach them. He went away a second time. Jesus went away a second time. And what did he do? He prayed. He's still trying to deal with his flesh. He's like, okay, I need to pray some more because I still feel what I'm feeling. I don't want to do this. I got to get with God some more and pray some more. God, I need more of you. I'm going to pray some more. He says, my Father, if it is not possible for this cup to be taken away, unless I drink it, unless I go through it, then fine. May your will be done. May your will be done. Next verse. When he came back again, he found them sleeping. And I don't criticize them because I'm telling you, that probably would be me. I like to sleep. I would be sleeping. But I find the more I am sleeping, whether it's physically sleeping or just mentally just not paying attention, I'm not keeping watch over myself and my emotions, that's when I stumble. That's when I'm easily offended. That's when I have negative thoughts come into my head. Okay? Because their eyes were heavy, so he left them and went away once more and prayed the third time, saying the same thing. Go back. There we go. Then he returned to the disciples and said to them, are you still sleeping and resting? Look, the hour has come and the Son of Man is delivered into the hands of sinners. Rise, let us go. Here comes my betrayer. In that moment, he's ready. It's time. Let's go. Danny, go back. Just keep going backwards until I find the scripture. Okay, go back. Wait, go back to the other one. There it is, right there, verse 41. A lot of you have heard this scripture. But I don't want it to be a Christianese thing, something that you just know and you ain't practicing, okay? Verse 40 says, then he returned to the disciples and found them sleeping. He said, couldn't you men keep watch with me for an hour? He asked Peter. Watch and pray so that you will not fall into temptation. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. So why are we watching and we're praying? Because we know our flesh is weak. Because we know our sinful nature. Just like the Apostle Paul knew the weakness of his sinful nature, we must know the weakness of our sinful nature. We must keep watch on it. We must stay praying over it because we know our flesh is weak, but we also know that the spirit of the living God who lives on the inside of you is willing to help you be obedient unto Christ, okay? But you have to choose Holy Spirit over choosing the flesh. That is the key to being aware of your emotions, managing your emotions, being aware of other people's emotions, managing their emotions, helping us as the body of Christ master a situation when we know emotions are flying. Can I get an amen? And it is so important for us to get this thing called EQ. Because I'm here to tell you, brothers and sisters, the enemy knows how weak we are. The enemy knows that physically he might be able to get us sick. You know, we can have colds, we can have fever, we can have sore stomach, we can have cancer, we can have all kinds of things physically. But it's the Spirit of God in us that is strong. So what is he gonna do? if he can come after your emotional state, however way he's doing it, then he can win the battle between flesh and spirit. Because if our emotions are out of whack, then we're going to go with our flesh. Unless in that moment we choose spirit. The only way for you to choose that is to be aware of it. The only way for you to choose it is to say, okay, God, like the Apostle Paul, I'm a mess. I am a sinner, and I automatically will think negative things. I automatically am going to feel negative things. I am automatically going to get offended because somebody looked at me wrong. I'm going to assume the worst. I don't assume the best. I don't give people the benefit of the doubt. So I need you. I'm going to go into my prayer closet and I'm going to ask for more of the Holy Spirit's empowerment. Right? Spend time with God Almighty and asking him to empower you with his spirit. Spend time with God Almighty dealing with your buttons. Okay? The moment I was aware of my buttons, the better I could manage my buttons. Because then I could see it coming. I'm like, oh, there it is. And I can stop myself before I trip on those buttons. Can I get an amen? Maybe the enemy is using a not your spouse. Maybe it's somebody else that he uses to mess with your emotions. But the bottom line is, if he can make you get all emotionally messed up, then you're not going to be walking in the power of the Spirit. You're going to be walking in your flesh. And that's why it is so, so important for us to master EQ, to grow in it, to grow in our understanding, to grow our ability to have emotional quotient. Because we are a people, we are God's people, and our ministry is to people. We are in the people business. And even if you're out there and you're like, well, I don't have to deal with people because I'm like an engineer or I work behind a computer by myself. No, you're going to deal with people. If you are going to be any good for Jesus at all, you're going to encounter a person. I don't know that you can be a disciple and not encounter people. Jesus expects us to disciple all nations. That includes people. So you may not see people at work, but you're going to see people in the world. You're definitely going to see people when you come to church. How are we going to be the body of Christ and represent God's love if we have issues with each other because our emotions are out of whack? Every time we turn around, somebody's offended. Every time we turn around, someone's angry. Every time we turn around, somebody left the church because somebody got offended because the pastor said this and I thought she was talking straight to me. Really? How many people are here? I'm not talking to any one person. You know? That's just because that person's emotions are out of control. They're easily offended. And so this is an area that I think God wants us to get a hold of. Amen? In closing, I want to read Psalm 43, verse 3 through 5. And the psalmist was in the midst of his own struggle, and he was under distress, and he was crying out to God. But this is what he says. He says, send out your light and your truth. Let them guide me. What is your guide? Your emotions are not your guide. The light and the truth of God is your guide. Let them lead me to your holy mountain, to the place where you live. There I will go to the altar of God, to God, the source of all my joy. I will praise you with my harp, O God, my God. Why am I discouraged? Follow him. He cries out to God, and he goes to the place where God is. Brothers and sisters, back then it was the temple. We don't have to have a physical temple anymore. You are the temple. So God is in you. So when you are feeling distressed and you're tormented and you're struggling, you turn to the God that is in you. Okay? You draw near to the God that is in you because he is your source of joy, right? And then as you praise him, even in the midst of your struggle, he's distressed and he says, I will praise you with my harp. It doesn't say, I'm going to wait till I'm happy and I'm okay, then I'm going to praise you. It says, I'm distressed. I'm going to go to the temple and I'm going to praise my God with my harp. For you, maybe it's your ukulele. Maybe it's your guitar. Maybe it's a piano. Maybe you just throw on YouTube. There's all kinds of worship available on YouTube now. Okay? And in the midst of his worship of his God, he has to ask himself a question. Why am I discouraged? He's standing in the presence of Almighty God, and he asks himself, why am I discouraged? Why is my heart so sad? I will put my hope in God. I will praise him again, my Savior and my God. In that moment when he asked himself the question, I believe that he was so overwhelmed by the goodness and the power and the presence and the love of God that he's given himself a pep talk, like, what's your problem? Why are you so discouraged? Why are you so sad? You have a relationship with the creator of the universe. You have a relationship with a God that is more than able to fix this situation. Can I get an amen? You have a relationship with a God who has so many armies that are available to him that in a moment when you cry out, he will send a legion of angels to save you. So why do we let the things of this world discourage us so? And in the midst of this worship, he has this revelation. He's like, oh my gosh, as I gaze upon this Almighty God, why am I so discouraged? Why am I so sad? I will put my hope in this God. I will put my trust in this God. I will have no fear. I will not be saddened. For the God of the universe is for me. Who can be against me? Amen. Brothers and sisters, that's my prayer for you. That if you're a person who is emotionally all over the map, go to this God in prayer who wants to show you that he is so much bigger than your emotions, than your situation, than your struggle, than your distress. He's so much bigger than that. And as you stand in his presence and worship him, this God who lives on the inside of you will begin to rise up joy, encouragement, strength, and you will begin to rejoice. And then people will look at you and like, why can you have this much peace? Like Alyssa, who's in the mainland. And you guys know, that's not like Aloha over here. I was just there. People are being killed 10 minutes away from her. Why can she walk the way she walks? Because she knows a God who is bigger than that situation. Because she has a walk with Jesus, an intimacy that says, my God is for me. I dare the devil to come after me. You will lose. That's the kind of faith that you get when you spend, like Jesus, time in prayer with a God who wants to save you. Would you stand as we close in prayer? With every eye closed and every head bowed, maybe you're here this morning and you've never put your faith in this man called Jesus Christ. And maybe after hearing the story of what he endured emotionally, spiritually, physically for you, maybe you want to come and put your faith in him. It's a free gift. You don't have to earn it. For the Bible tells us that while we were still sinners, Jesus gave his life for us. And all we need to do is call upon the name of Jesus, confess that he is the Lord over our lives, and we will be saved. We will never be separated from God again. We will never suffer death. We will have life eternal with him. With every eye closed and every head bowed, if that's you here today and you want to put your life in the hands of Jesus for the very first time, would you raise your hand? I would want to pray for you. Maybe you're here today and you've already put your faith in Christ, but you fell away from him and you live according to your own ways and you don't cry out to God to lead you and to guide you. You're just kind of leading and guiding yourself. But you want to rededicate your life to him and say, Father God, I don't want to live my way anymore. I want you to be in the driver's seat. I want you to lead me. I want you to guide me in all of my life. If that's you here today, with every eye closed and every head bowed, would you raise your hand? I want to pray for you as well. I see you, brother. I see you, sister. You can put your hands down. Would you all repeat this after me? Say, Heavenly Father, I thank you for your son, Jesus Christ, who died for me so that I could have life eternal with you. Lord, thank you that Jesus shows me how to overcome my flesh and live victoriously with you. I now rededicate my life to you. I take my hands off of the steering wheel and I allow for you to drive my life. I surrender to you as the Lord of my life to lead me and to guide me in my thoughts, in my emotions, and in my physical deeds. I thank you that you, the God of the universe, loves me, cares for me, protects me, and guides me. In Jesus' name I pray these things. And all of God's children said, amen, amen. Would you give the Lord a hand clap? If you made some kind of decision or some kind of recommitment to the Lord today, would you let us know about it on the communication card? I pray that as you go out today, rejoice that you can have victory over your emotions. We just need to submit them to the Lordship of Jesus Christ. And I pray that you would stick with us for the next several weeks because we're going to learn more on how to raise our emotional quotient.